I'm telling you, Michael, I've tried my best, but writing this play is making me stressed. Just tell the producer I've changed my mind. What's the problem? It's not as though I've signed a contract or something.
Is this a joke? Helen, you know I'm a reasonable bloke, but you've been adapting this play for weeks. You can't back out now with a deadline to meet. What is the cause of this sudden despair?
Jean-Baptiste Poquelin.
Who?
Molière. Compared to Molière, I'm a talentless fraud. Everything I've written is deeply flawed. Sallow, insipid, mediocre shit. This adaptation is finished. I quit.
That's all this is. An attack of self-doubt. You're not the first writer to suffer a bout of artistic malaise. Why can't you see? Your writing is good.
Don't patronise me.
Okay, I grant you, you're no Molière.
Oh, thank you.
No, listen, you can't compare yourself to Chekhov or Ibsen or Brecht. You'll never write anything if you expect to be as good as William Shakespeare. Nobody writes blank verse anymore, dear.
Don't compare myself to the man, you say. Despite the fact I'm rewriting his play, the fact is I just can't bear to compose another sentence of terrible prose. And don't even mention rhyming couplets. I couldn't find a rhyme if my life depended on it.
What will it take to convince you that you're better than you give yourself credit for? You're as bad as the one who wrote this play.
Which play?
The one we're in right now.
Okay.
He always doubts his own talents like you and wishes he could write like Molière too. But it's obvious he'll never be that good, but he keeps on writing in case he should happen to create a great work of art. The point is you never know. So take heart. Writing is an itch that needs to be scratched.
Well, I suppose when you put it like that, the compulsion to write is hard to resist. And God knows I could write better than this. All right, Michael, as usual, you win. I'll try to silence the critic within.
We've had this argument so many times. By now, we ought to know each other's lines.
Arrived today. This is the 7th sponge I have ordered this year. In fact, not even this year, just since March. Haven't even used it yet, but I can tell it's going to be just as useless as the other 6. I mean, what is going on with the sponge industry? A global crisis isn't an excuse for shoddy sponges, is it? I don't know where it all went wrong. For years I had the same sponge. And that was bought because it was the same as the one I had before then. Which also lasted years. I bought it in France. I think. It had the word éponge on the packet. I've never seen another one like it since. I knew my one wouldn't last forever, so I did keep an eye out, but it never seemed like a serious issue. It's just a sponge. It's just a sponge. Just a sponge. But once that one started to fall apart, I knew I had to get a new one. So I scoured the internet. All manner of weird looking sponges. I ordered one that seemed okay. You know, good reviews. First time in the bath and I didn't even think about it, you know. Next thing I know, bits of it are coming off. It was bloody brand new. So, I ordered another one. Looked completely different, but, you know, still good reviews. Same thing. So I went way out there for the next one. You know, bizarre, spherical looking thing. It was like trying to clean yourself with a rotten grapefruit. So then I went upmarket. Really expensive one. A prince of sponges. Barely lasted a week. And then my mother intervened. Posted me a frilly one. She said not to think about it. Just to use it. It's a really good one. More like trying to get clean with a dead chihuahua in your hand. The next one was bought based on good reviews for durability. It was a horrid little thing to hold, but at least it lasted longer than the other ones. It's now falling apart though. Home's number 7 over there. I don't know what to do now. Can't exactly go to France to get one. Can't even go to a local shop. Not allowed out my front door. Why doesn't the bloody internet stack my sponge? Still, I suppose it's given me something to pass the time.
Anything. You never have to say anything when you look at me like that. I can read your mind when you look at me like that. Where have you been? Right, you wanna know? I don't know where I've been. I was at home. I know that sounds really unhelpful and evasive, but I don't really know how else to phrase it. I was just out. Nowhere in particular, with nobody in particular. I just walked for ages. In these shitty, uneven Primani heels. You know, I swear when I bought these, one of them was like half a centimetre shorter than the other, because I know I walk like a penguin and anything taller than Converse. But I'm pretty sure I don't walk so lopsided that I've worn them down unevenly. It was about 2 a.m. and I couldn't sleep. I decided to go through my wardrobe, I don't know why. And I put on this dress. I haven't worn it since I was 18 and I wasn't even sure I was going to fit it anymore. But when I saw it in my wardrobe, I was like, you have to try that on again. And I looked in the mirror. I felt so good. So before I knew it, it was like mascara, lipstick, eyebrows, heels. Trying to be really quiet, trying not to wake you and mum up. There are these really, really rare moments in life when you feel fucking fantastic. I felt so good. And I just wanted to show the world. So I grab my keys and my phone and this silly bag that I own for no reason other than when I'm wearing a black dress and lipstick, and I walked. I walked until the sky brightened and my phone was hanging on for dear life at 1%. but I felt like a goddess under the light of the sunrise. And I cried. Because the magic of it wasn't going to last, was it? So that's where I've been. I know it's stupid. I know it's not the most sensible thing to do. Trust me, it's not going to happen again. I just really, really would like to feel beautiful. Like that, all the time. And I don't, I feel like nothing. Most of the time. So you can back off now, okay? Because I wasn't having unprotected sex in a car park. I was just walking.
I'm going on during this time. I feel there's no one to save me. This all and nothing really
goes
driving me crazy. I need somebody to hear.
Oh, sorry, mate. I need to go because there's someone else in here. I'll go.
It's okay, mate. You can stay if you want. Hiya, mate.
Oh, no. Oh, this is
sad. I can always come.
No. I didn't.
I was joking, mate. How are you, bro?
I'm fine. How are you here?
I'm always here.
Oh, Christ. How much have I had to drink?
That's got nothing to do with it. You called, I came.
I didn't say anything. I never called for you.
You did. You just didn't know it. How's the party?
It's alright. I thought if I came, if I pushed myself out of my comfort zone a bit, then maybe I'd feel better, but man, it's so horrible. I'm thinking about what happened, about you. That would be mad.
I'm here now, aren't I?
Yeah, but you're not though, are you? I can't touch you. I can't hold you. It's a figment of my imagination.
I'm a bit more than that. I was real at one point.
Yeah, I know you live up here in my head. I only pop out to say hello when I'm at my lowest, which I guess is now.
I'm just trying to help.
But it's not working.
That's not true, though, is it? You always feel better after our little chats.
Shut up. When will it start getting easier?
When you stop blaming yourself for what happened.
How can I not?
Because what I did wasn't because of you. I did what I did because of me and me alone. You tried your best, but...
just wasn't enough?
Stop it.
I wish you were here.
Ray. You're doing fine without me.
Ray, but I'm not. I'm not fine. I miss you, Paul. I miss my brother, so...
Missing you.
Hey there. I miss you too.
So, I've had an idea.
Me too.
Oh yeah, what's yours?
We could take up knitting and each knit a scarf, which at the end of lockdown, we join as one.
Oh.
What's yours?
Nothing.
What do you mean, nothing? Hey, come on. I told you mine, it's only fair. What's yours?
Phone sex?
Sex with a phone. Where do you put it?
No, not sex with a phone. Sex on the phone.
On a phone. I don't understand.
You really want to know?
Well, yeah. Well, what do you do?
Well, it's like, you know, we... sort of say stuff.
Like what?
Like, you know, like, take off your cardi.
I'm not wearing a cardi.
No, that was just an example.
And supposing I was wearing a cardi, what do I do?
You take it off.
And would I tell you to take something off?
Now you're getting it.
Oh, cool. Shall I start?
Sure.
Okay. Take off your shoes.
My shoes?
What's wrong with that?
Sorry, no, I just wasn't expecting, no, ooh, yeah, fine, good, they're off.
Put on your slippers.
No, hang on.
What?
Well, no, that's not what you do.
Why not?
Well, it's not very sexy, is it, put on your slippers?
I don't see why not. You're getting ready for something romantic when you put on your slippers.
Slippers aren't romantic.
Speak for yourself.
Okay.
We're not going to get very far if you keep questioning everything I say.
No, I'm really sorry. Right, okay, let's cut to the chase. Are you wearing jeans?
Yeah, look.
Okay, yeah. Good. Put your hands down your jeans.
Which hand?
Which hand? Okay, the one you masturbate with.
Bloody hell. That's very close to the bone.
Yeah, so I imagine.
The one I masturbate with. Right, let me think. Okay. Oh, okay, cool.
What are you doing?
These jeans, they're so tight, I can't...
undo them. Undo your jeans.
No, I'm really there. Ow! Ow! Ow!
What?
Oh, I really hurt my hand. Oh, you know, those little bones in the top, what are they? Tendons. I've really hurt my tendons.
Tendons, James.
If you're going to be like that.
Oh, okay, that's it. I'll knit the scarf.
It really hurt.
It's all right. It was a stupid idea anyway. Can I ask you something?
Do you want the pattern?
No. I was wondering, when you masturbate, do you use one finger or two? Babe, did you hear me? Babe, what are you doing? You've stopped your video?
Yeah, I've undone my jeans.
Have you?
Yeah, it was when you said that thing. One finger or two. I went all funny.
Why have you switched off?
Oh, I'm masturbating.
Oh. Turn it back on, turn it back on.
No, I'm going to mute now as well.
Why?
Well, okay, it's private, masturbating. Oh, bye.
No, babe, because this is it. This is what I was, babe. Shit. Where are those needles?
Was there ever a time we danced a reel? Fearlessly spinning, arms entwined, almost breathless. Feels like yesterday. Fresh-faced bride, eyes bright, a heart full of hope. All brides are beautiful, of course. Just a pity about the puffy sleeves. I wonder what happened to the dress. The band strikes up, and we charge forward, fearless, for the dashing white sergeant. Oh, the audacity of it all. Four steps forward, four steps back. You remember how it went when it was fun bumping into strangers without even having to wash your hands. Now it's just the two of us marching to a different tune. It's a strange and unpredictable rhythm with seemingly endless verses. Discordant notes, unpleasant at times, encircling us in giant waves. Now we dance a careful pas de deux, 2 meters apart, or one if we're properly in Europe. They told us to keep our distance. So we stick to the rules. Now, we stumble around in dressing gowns,
trying not to step on box sets or plates with remnants of store cupboard suppers. Never touching. Not even accidentally. 2 steps forward, 1 to the side. Careful not to tread on each other's toes while trying not to remember the way we used to dance. Spinning, fearless, engaging, breathless. The photo on the mantelpiece in the silver frame is gathering dust, bringing into sharp focus the distance between us. Because if truth be told, we've been sitting on separate sofas for a while now.
I get a call from you saying you had something to tell me. And now I think about it, you didn't sound sad. Really, I don't think you sounded sad. Or even angry, actually. Or ashamed. It just felt, well, it just felt sort of necessary. The way you said it. I wasn't even worried. I thought, I don't know, I thought 100 things, but I trust you. I trusted you so much. It didn't even cross my mind that you... I'm trying to think of a word other than cheated because I sort of hate that word. I've always hated that word. That idea in people's minds that love is a game, that trope in songs. Cheating makes it sound like you ignored the rules of the game to win. I guess there's a reason it's a cliche. Thing about cheating in games though is it's not satisfying when you win, is it? Yeah, I remember this one Christmas. And there was a power cut of all things. We were in the middle of watching the Doctor Who Christmas special and the lights go out. Heather was so pissed. Mum, yeah, you know how she is. Tries to make the most of everything. Whips out Monopoly. I'm like 9. And I cheated. When Mum and Heather went out to get a drink, I stole some extra money. And I won, and it felt good for a minute, and then it felt like shit. It felt so shit, and all I wanted to do was tell my mum to get rid of this guilt. So don't pretend to me that you told me because you thought it would be good for us. It wasn't for anyone but yourself. And now, Ella, now I'd like to forget. And I think after everything you've done, I think I'm allowed to.
Thank you. Number one, when people talk about something that they really, really love, they don't know it, but watch their faces come alive with joy.
Two, cows have best friends. Three, rats laugh when they're tickled. And four, dolphins sing to their babies.
Number five. The actors who voiced Mickey and Minnie Mouse were married in real life. Number six. In 1914, German and British soldiers stopped fighting to play a game of football on Christmas Day. Seven. All matter is made from stars. And eight. We drink the same water that the dinosaurs did. Everything is a part of everything else. Number nine. A man from Australia had a rare blood type. So he donated blood every 3 weeks for 64 years and saved the lives of 2.4 million children. Can you imagine a love like that? Number 10. A woman called Marie Robinson sat at her son's grave, and a robin flew down, landed on her hand, stayed there for a few minutes, until eventually it flew away.
Number 11. Window cleaners dress up like Spider-Man to cheer up sick kids in hospital.
Number 12. An astronaut once wrote his daughter's initials on the moon. The newsreader said that they're going to be there for at least 50,000 years. Number 13, the Russian word for astronaut means star sailor. 14, cats purr themselves when they're worried. And 15, they bring their catches to us because they think we can't hunt. Number 16, being kind actually releases endorphins. And 17, we want to share good news more than bad. And 18, people blind from birth smile even though they've never seen one. We are all meant to be happy. 19, I once saw this video where someone was feeding sugar water to a dying bumblebee. Not for any real reason, but just because they could. 20. We are all miracles. Links in a chain spanning 4 billion years. The chances of you being you are practically zero. And yet, here you are.
21. If you're hearing this, you've survived everything. Keep going.
22. Painting legend Bob Ross said, however you think it should be, that's exactly how it should be.
23. There are so many more public libraries than there are branches of McDonald's. 24. You know that kid from Educating Yorkshire? You know, the one with the stutter? Well, he's now a motivational speaker. Amazing.
Number 25. Recently, I need to tell you about this, right? Recently, I've been reading about sea otters. Apparently, they sleep on their backs in the water and they hold hands with each other to stop them drifting apart and losing themselves at sea. 26. They do exactly the same for their pups. A scientist once said that they embrace their young with an affection that is barely credible. 27.
Oi! Hey! Yeah, you! Yo! Hello? You can come closer if you like. I won't bite. I can't. I'm basically a slab of iron. That's better, isn't it? You can see all the details now. I've been sculpted to highlight the complexities of 2020. Note the smartphone clenched in one raised fist and the anti-COVID-19 face mask. I'm waiting for the additional digital placard in my other hand, which will show a range of issues people protested about. And there are so many of them. Ah. From environmental catastrophes to incompetent politicians, to the fact that some humans continue to injure and kill other humans just because of the color of their skin. A fact which, speaking as an impartial observer, strikes me as being devastating, infuriating, and incomprehensible all at the same time. Not that my opinion counts or anything, of course. Statues can't have opinions. Duh. You create us to represent an ideal that you believe in for a certain period of time. And you keep changing your minds. Edward Colston is known as a Bristolian merchant and philanthropist. He's also known as a slave trader, but his statue wasn't toppled until 2020. Sir Winston Churchill, one of your country's great leaders, was once a member of the government that authorized the force feeding of suffragettes, and his statue still stands. Perhaps you can only embody one idea at a time. In years to come, I may be seen as a passionate young advocate for change, or a waste man causing trouble because I'm too lazy to do anything useful, guy. And I'm powerless to change that. I wish I could start my own movement. A delegation of aggrieved statues marching to Westminster, protesting about the fact that we stand out here in all weathers while flocks of incontinent birds use us for target practice. But I can't do that because, newsflash, statues can't move. Duh. It's time for you to tell the untold stories and explore the different perspectives. Maybe it's time to tear down the old icons. How you shape the new ones is up to you. Your past is always shifting. Your present is uncertain. The future is yours to sculpt. But then, I'm just a slab of iron. What do I know? In 100 years, I might be in storage, in pieces, or reduced to a fruitless lump. But until then, I'll stand and watch you with interest.